this is a shi-shi-ai bori chisel. I call it the safety edge chisel. The reason for that is that it's only this cutting edge here, that line, that cuts. Because of the geometry of the chisel, and the shape of it, really, this edge here doesn't cut. So on this corner, it's literally only the front edge that cuts. And we achieve this geometry by filing the blank into an elliptical shape. So these faces here are rounded into a lens shape. And then just like the basic katakiri chisel or basic mortise chisel that I did in the first episode of chisel making, we have the two faces at a 60 degree angle to each other. I'll demonstrate how this is used in a moment. This is sort of a standard configuration, and this is the same type of chisel, and this one a little bit shallower, so the angles are much more acute. This is the kind of chisel I would use if I was carving fine silver or gold, so metal that's significantly softer. I find that sometimes having a sharper chisel, a more acute angle, pairs the metal away a little more easily. Also, if I'm doing very, very fine work, and I'm literally trying to take slivers of metal away, I might use something that's a little bit more delicate, like this one. The con of this kind of configuration is that because it's such a sharp edge, it can chip more readily, so you have to be careful about what you use it on. So the geometry can vary a little bit in that respect. But this is the standard 60 degree configuration. I'm going to show you how it's used now, and then we'll go on to the steps you go through to create the basic chisel.
Right, so here we are. I've done two preparatory cuts, just the lee cuts. And up close now, this is the safety edge we're talking about. As I said, it's only this edge that can cut. So that corner only cuts just there. Same over here. So what we're going to do is we're going to put the chisel in the bottom of the groove, but angling it ever so slightly. Instead of the chisel being at 90 degrees, as soon as it's at 90 degrees, there's a risk that that corner could dig in to this left-hand wall of the V. We don't want that. So we're going to angle it ever so slightly. So from 90 degrees, just sort of, so that this edge is sloping back a little bit. So it's as if it's sort of dragging. So by coming in an angle, this safety edge here can run along this wall of the V-cut. So as I go in there, I take it, and I can see the chisel go to the bottom. I can see it's just not catching because the safety edge is running on the left-hand side of the V-cut. So that was just a slight angle. Now I'm going to do a bit more. Same principle. Basically leaning the chisel away from the wall you want to protect. Like that a little bit more. Now I'm not actually resting on the wall at all. I'm just paring away metal. I go to the other side, again, that would be 90 degrees in relation to the length of the cut, angling it ever so slightly to avoid the sharp corner digging in. And out. Come again, at a slightly more shallow angle. We pretend, or we can imagine this as a section of bamboo. Go back to the other side. Okay.
And then to finish up, to make it into a piece of bamboo.
So we're taking a standard katakiri chisel, like we did in the first episode, and make a little node. And there you have it, piece of bamboo. Right, now I want to demonstrate how you use the sated chisel to pare metal away from an undulating curved line. Now, what's really important here is the relationship of the chisel face to the particular part of the curve. What you have to imagine is that a circle, of course, and this is part of a circle, has lines radiating from a center point. So they go, these lines are supposed to give you an indication of 90 degrees coming off that line, wherever it is. A curve is a series of tiny little straight pieces. If you think of it in those terms, the chisel always has to be aligned correctly with its position on the curve. That way you'll have an even flow of the cut. So I'm going to try and demonstrate this now. Here you have to be more careful than a straight because we can't really slope it too much. We can slope it a little bit, but we have to bear in mind the relationship, the 90 degree relationship to the direction of the line. This is where you really have to think ahead so that when I reach this point, I'm in the correct alignment. It's almost as though the chisel's pivoting on itself. Careful not to oversteer. Gotta bring that back end around. Here they are. Hit the mark. And we can carry on. So the back, this side, the outside of the chisel here, is doing more movement than here. So if you watch the back end of the chisel, it's swinging around quite a lot, if that makes sense. Right, so now we're going to go through the steps as I teach them in class that will lead us to the shape we want. I like to suggest that these kata, these steps, be followed because it might seem like a lot of extra filing, but it does set you up at the end for a really precise tool, and it does allow you to spend some time practicing very precise filing, which of course you're going to need, particularly as we get to grips with more complicated chisels. We'll get to the dreaded V chisel next, and that will require some very precise filing. So this procedure is to help us create a nice, even, rounded profile on this chisel. So we're going to ignore the cutting geometry at the tip for now, and we're just going to turn this shaft, this tool, into an ellipse from about here to here. This is a blank that's been prepared as demonstrated in the first video of this series of chisel making, the basic chisel episode number one. This is episode number two, I suppose. So here we go. First thing I want to do is establish the oval. So taking a fine cut file, a number 2 or a number 4, I'm going to file just the tip into the ellipse I want. I'm going to do that. Can you see that, I hope? Notice how I'm rolling the tool. I'll do the other side. Rolling the tool to meet the chisel. I've taken two little nicks off. Now I'm going to put that into a neat transitional curve. Notice how I'm resting the file on the bench peg and the tools on the bench peg, and I'm pivoting them against each other. Everything's being supported very carefully. And I can see the face of the chisel bank. Looking directly down on it. So there I have the little lens shape, like a little eye shaped on the tip. What I wanted to avoid, of course, as I'm filing, is that I don't make the tool too narrow in this section. You need the width, and I've deliberately taken a blank that's quite thick here, so that you can really see when I put the angles on. All right, so you could have this slightly thinner, but I'd recommend using something a little bit thicker to start with. So it's a rectangular section, obviously wider than it is thick. You want a little bit of thickness so you can achieve a reasonable ellipse on the end. Now, I can hold the tool like this, and I can see how far I need to file down. I'm going to do that. I'm going to use the magic cut file. Don't be intimidated by these. I've talked about these in the first video as well. You can use a smaller hand file, a number 1 coarse cut, or a 0 coarse cut. The downside is your surface of this tool is much narrower, so there is a possibility that you can wobble, whereas with a larger file you've got much more support. So I prefer and recommend using a bigger file. And we start way back here, about the thickest point of the tool. That's where we're going to start. And I'm going to put a bevel on here. I'm going to start here, and I'm just going to angle the tool. And it's locked in here. I've got a little notch in here. So this can be really quite secure. It's not wobbling at all. And my finger is under there. So this is all nice and secure. Really, really, very important. Both of my feet are on the ground. My right foot closest to the camera here, is further back, and my arm has a free movement here. All right, so let's put a bevel on here. I'm establishing a bevel here. Notice the chisel isn't moving at all. It's nice and steady. Doesn't take much pressure. Now, I've established a little plane. And I'm going to come off that and take it to the tip. I'm not trying to finish this in one go. All right, so I've got a plane running along here to the tip. It started to cut into that little bit at the end. I'm going to go back and bring it through again, one even pass. And remember what I said in the first video, we never go off the end. Always stop short so the tool is supported. Coming back to the start, moving forward again. Back to the start and moving forward again. Now I'm aiming for a nice even plane. Doing everything in one go now. From here to here. A little bit more pressure on the front. I'm stopping short every time. Just there. So just over the tip. I'm trying to keep this nice and flat. And that's it. Constantly get rid of the filings. Can't see what you're doing if you're covered in muck. So now we have a nice flat plane here. Look at that. Isn't that beautiful? Even though I say so myself. And I've got to the tip here and I've just stopped a fraction short. So I can still see a tiny little bit of that initial shaping. And I'm going to do the same bevel on this side. Starting at the back, as before. Establish a bit of a flat. Now I can move forward.
Forward, can you just talk about how you haven't moved your file? So your file's in the same position.
How do you mean the plane?
Yeah. That the tool is turned round rather than moving the file to pick the next side.
Okay. You're still running. Okay. Right. So one thing to point out as I'm doing this, oftentimes it's a strange thing. I find students are comfortable doing this side, but when they come to do this side, somehow something in the brain turns upside down. In fact, all that's happened is you've moved the tool. The filing is still exactly the same action. All that's happened is the tool has been offered at a different angle. So you have a square section and you're just offering the corner. That's all that's happened. If I demonstrate with a little box. So there's a box. I want to file this corner here, along here. I don't file like that and then try to file like that. I simply offer the thing to me at this angle and file as I would normally. And then I turn it and I file that one exactly the same. Okay? And as you're doing this, as you're bringing this plane in, and you have a look at the other one, and I see, oh, it's not quite the same angle, and even if I keep going, it's not going to have quite the same angle, and it's not that critical, but really you do want things to be as symmetrical as they can be at each stage of this kata, of this sequence of steps. So I can see this needs to come over a bit more. So I need to change the angle I'm offering the tool at. So it's there, I need to lean it over so I catch more of this edge. The micro plane on top of the other now. Re-establish the angle. Is that going to be all right? Maybe needs a little bit more work to push it over a little bit more. Two planes, pretty much the same, and there's the side. So having established the two major bevels, I now need to put a very small one on the edge here to bring it to the halfway point, and similarly one across this point here. So create a new plane between this on this one. So use the magic cut again, starting way back here, putting a little flat on. Very important to keep this dead steady. And I'm just going to move forward very, very gently.
that's that. I'll come back a little bit more. I can literally feel the metal coming away under my fingers. And that's as far as I want to go. So I've now established the edge of this curve. This line now, that's as far as this filing will go. That is the halfway point, just there, of the ellipse. That's the edge of the eye, if you like, looking from this side. Now I'm going to put another bevel between this face and the top. Coming way back here again. Teeth are quite large on this, so I've had some little ripples here, but I now have a series of little bevels there. I'm going to do the opposite side, back here. Nice and straight, and then the last one, the top. Now hopefully you can see the start of a nice curved surface there, albeit lots of little microplanes. It's not a lot of work now to blend those in very carefully and thereby get a nice even transition. And that's what this procedure is all about. Although we're making a long curved shaft here, this technique would apply in principle to making a round ring, a disc, any area that you're trying to get a nice even curve to. You set it up with little planes first. And then using a finer file, I'm going to use a fine cut now. I'm going to start moving along the edge here. Now, I start in the middle, and I'm going to roll the tool away from me so my file marks, like a little wave, will move towards this edge. And I'll be able to watch it because this is a fine cut, and I'll be able to see, and hopefully you will be able to see, as I bring that line to that edge. I'm going to bring it forward like a little wave. The tool will keep working evenly, and I will roll this. So starting in the middle of that curve, very gently. So moving along the whole length, establish a nice plane, and then very gently rolling the chisel blank. So that my filing slowly proceeds like a little wave, and I can see very clearly when it hits that line. A little bit more work towards the tip, and then I can roll back. So I'm rolling the tool back towards you now, and my little filed wave is proceeding very evenly to the center line. Roll it back a little bit. So all these little lines are just blending in and resulting in a very even curve. So that side's done. You can see how the light plays on it. And the way the light plays, of course, tells you that it's straight. Like it was done by a machine. Right, so we're going to do the other one. Starting in the middle again, in the middle of that quarter. So I'm going to start about there, move to the edge, and then roll back. Okay? Again, using a fine file, I'm starting way back here. And I start playing, and I start rolling forward.
really important to be able to see what you're doing. And I can see the light playing on every new stroke. You could put marker pen on the steel if you wanted, Sharpie or something, so you could have a clearer view. But really, you can see, if you pay attention, you can see the metal changing. Both the file cut, the metal's bright again. Now I'm rolling back to the center again. Very gently, every stroke taking up the whole length. And of course, being very careful not to roll over the end. One last pass forward. And that's that.
There we have it. A nice, even transition. You can see how the light plays across that.
Okay.
There's no dips, no unnecessary wobbles. And that's because we started back here and move the whole length. So you're setting yourself up for success back here where you can control things, and you bring it down to the tip, and we haven't rolled over the tip, and that initial shaping has now all been blended in. There we have it. Having done the one side, I'm now going to do the other side in real time as I do it without stopping to talk about it. But first, I want to talk about my setup. This is the famous iron brush filing and sawing tower. You'll find plans for this on the forum. I'll put a link in below. So there's your piercing side for piercing work. And this is for filing. And it's just clamped to a bench. I devised this when teaching because the bench height is ideal for carving, but not so good for when you're doing filing or piercing work and you find yourself too hunched over. So I devised these. They're quite handy. You might want to make one. As I say, the plans are available on the forum, link in the descriptor below. When holding steel blanks or any small piece of metal and you're filing, particularly if you're filing very fast and efficiently, a little piece of metal like this will get really hot really quickly, such that you won't be able to hold it. Also, your hands will get very tired trying to hold this steady while you're filing on it. This is where the hand vise comes in really handy. These have been used by goldsmiths for hundreds of years. This is a version I particularly like. It's got a nice wooden handle. I don't particularly favor the little metal engineers ones, although they would work. What I like about this is it's unhardened steel, and it's very easy to simply widen the hole at the bottom here. So I drilled that out. You can take this piece out off and you can put it in a clamp and drill out that hole here. So it takes the chisel blank like so. Michael Coffey rather cleverly suggested we do it at an angle. Well done, Mike. Heads up to you. And you can lock it. Now it's secured in the hole in the bottom, and because of Mike's clever advice, it's across the faces, it's nice and secure. Now with all of this in my hand, I can hold it quite securely against the bench peg. This will save your hands and provide a lot more stability. Chisel blanks, I mentioned in the previous video that these are W1. We have difficulty finding W1 steel in the UK. I recently tried using silver steel. This is a basic tool steel that has about 1% carbon. And about just under 0.5% carbon, so but presumably won't rust so regularly. I'm not holding my breath. But it does heat treat in the same way. So if you can't get W1 and you can get silver steel in the UK or Europe, you can use that and you can follow the same procedure as outlined in the previous chisel making video. Right, I'm going to proceed now and do it in my own time, and hopefully you'll glean some insight into how I use my files and how I operate. Okay, here we go. So here you can see the little ellipse has now been transferred throughout the section of the tool, and the sides, which were flat, come down to a little point just there. Nice
nice rounded face of both. Now I'm going to put the cutting faces on. And just like the very first chisel, the cutting chisel, or the basic firmer type chisel, mortise chisel, there we have the two faces in that sort of relationship. We're going to make ours slightly more acute, that is to say a little sharper. But essentially, it's this principle, just those two faces, a short face and a big face. The only difference being it's on an oval or lens cross-section. So what it means is instead of having a rectangular cutting face here, it's going to be a little half moon. And of course, if this isn't nice and even, the half moon's going to be offside or leaning over to one side. So we'll find out how accurate I was.
So a couple of strokes on one side. Just make sure the face is flat. Yeah. It's important
that that top be at 90 degrees to the length of the tool. It's no good having that cutting face at an angle. There's a secret use for something like that I'll talk about
in years to come. Right, first angle.
Now I'm not going to go all the way because I need to heat treat this. So that's one face, and I brought it nearly to the tip. I'll do the other side.
I'll make this one a little bit more short, a little shorter. There's a little
untouched strip along the edge. I want to take it down a little bit more, but I want to leave a little sliver at the end so that when I heat treat, I've got a little bit of substance. I don't want to heat treat on an absolutely fine edge at this point. I'm concerned about these little corners here. They're quite delicate. That is it. That is the tool ready for heat treatment. That's already explained in episode 1, basic chisel making. So there you have it. There's the angles, as I said, a little bit more acute than the katakuri. And it's, as it's used, of course, the flat is on the metal and can rest on that plane and it can skim along like a woodworker's plane. Of course, if it's on the short one, you have a little bit more of an angle. That's why one is short and one is angle. One is long and one is short. You have two different angles as a consequence when you're chiseling. Long face down, you're more shallow. Short face, and you're higher up. Make sense? Hope so. Anyway, there you have it. The shi-shi-ai bori, or complexion carving tool. Complexion in this instance meaning the subtle variations that you can achieve in intaglio carving. The belief is that this tool was developed by an artist called Sigurura Joy, whose work is characterized by intaglio work, which is to say he outlines the design with a V-chisel and then all the carving is done within that space. So it's a relief carving, but it's sunken into the ground, a bit like Egyptian murals also. Legend has it that Sigurura Joy invented this chisel to do that, so he could safely carve along the edges of the V cuts that he'd made. There's another associated chisel that would be used alongside this, the Skidashi Bori chisel. We'll get to that in due course. This may well be your new favorite chisel. It's ideal for doing things like Celtic knotwork. If you outline the pattern with a V chisel, and then you would do all of the carving, paring away with something like this. it's ideal for that kind of work. Yeah, you can thank me later. I look forward to seeing lots of shi-shi-ai bori safety edge chisels in the future. Thanks for watching.